to this edition of Inside Auburn Hills. Today we're going to be talking about Avondale Schools and all the wonderful accomplishments that have happened over the past several years. And today we're joined by Superintendent George Heitsch. Thank you for being here. And Avondale Academy Principal Chuck Granger. We have Kimberly Allison and Kimberly's mother, Megan. So thank you all for being here today.
Well, thank you for having us.
George, why don't you start off by telling us a little bit about the school district and which communities it serves?
Well, we have we serve about 3,800 students in seven schools, four elementaries, middle school that has 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, Avondale High School, and Avondale Academy. The majority of our students come from the City of Auburn Hills, Troy, Rochester Hills, in Bloomfield Township, and then through the Avondale Academy, we also serve students from neighboring communities.
Great, and I'm glad you brought up the Academy because that's kind of one of the focuses of our conversation today. How does the Academy fit in with the mission of Avondale Schools?
Well, part of our mission is to educate students to their fullest potential, and we found that through the Academy, we're able to offer a range of educational opportunities for students that may not have been as comfortable in a comprehensive high school or may have life needs that need to be worked around. So we have a virtual school, a traditional high school, and an afternoon experience for students that they can do online learning in.
Yep, and we'll talk about the virtual aspect more in depth soon. So it really just gives students another opportunity to graduate with their diploma.
Correct. Yeah, it provides them the opportunity and also the option to find a pathway that really meets their needs and fits their learning structure and style.
Great. Chuck, you are the principal of the Avondale Academy. How long have you been with the Academy and what changes have you implemented during your tenure there?
Well, first of all, I've been there 6 years. And I think some of the significant changes are when I first, the staff that I inherited, only 20% of them are left. Of the staff that we've hired, they've all been there 4 years minimum, and they are all highly qualified in their position, and they have multiple endorsements. I think one of the things that we as a philosophy did when the students walk in the door is try to figure out what their needs are, because they came to us for a reason. Maybe their home school failed them academically, didn't meet their social needs, their emotional needs. And we try to encompass that knowledge into our approach of how we're going to educate them. We look at multiple ways of presenting curriculum, and some of the changes that we've made that are significant for their academic growth are test-taking program that every student's required to take. We have after-school tutoring. And this has made a significant impact on our ACT scores because we've raised them 4 years consecutively. 4 years ago, we started an afternoon program that runs right after our day program. So our school basically is open from 7:20 in the morning to 8 o'clock at night. And then 3 years ago, this would be the start of our fourth year, we began a virtual program. We're one of the first schools in the state to have one of these. We've graduated 11 kids through that, and that is part of our average graduation rate of about 35 to 40 students per year. We have a program with Baker College that's really significant. This is our third year of that, whereas a student can be dual enrolled with Baker College while they're fulfilling their high school requirements. And we have increased our student population by about 200%.
How many students are currently enrolled at the Academy?
Right now, 127.
That's great.
And that is a number that grows every day.
It is. Now, how have the programs like the virtual online learning, how has that helped the students succeed?
Well, I would say there's two parts of that program. There's a virtual program and the afternoon program that's just made a huge impact on students. Many of our students are parents, so they watch their baby during the day, maybe when a grandparent or a cousin or someone's working, and then their friend can watch their baby, and they can be in our afternoon program. The virtual program can meet the same needs, but we also have health issues that students can't come to school. They may be homebound, or they may have anxiety issues. So the virtual program gives them a core curriculum that meets all the state requirements, and they can ultimately graduate from high school.
So it sounds like regardless of any limitations that they may have or any personal or issues at home, that you're really giving them an opportunity to succeed and get their diploma.
That's 100% our goal.
Great.
Every kid deserves an opportunity for an education, and there's many, many ways. Students are different today than they were 10, 15 years ago, and it's up to us as educators to figure out the avenue by which to educate them.
As we all know, education is facing some major challenges. It seems like something is changing monthly as we get word from Lansing, and I understand that alternative education is facing some even greater challenges. George, why don't you share with us what some of those challenges are and how you hope to overcome them?
Well, the largest challenge that we face in alternative education is the flexibility and mobility and sometimes lack of structure that some of the students have had previously before they've come to the academy. Alternative education gets a bad rap sometimes because those are often students that systems have failed previously, and they don't have the foundation to really prepare them for the next step of their education. So I think that's a major challenge. You know, the other major challenge that we face in alternative education is this idea that everybody's ready to progress at the same rate and a one size of education fits all. In alternative education, students have proven to us that that's not true and that we need to react to them and be flexible with them and find alternate pathways for them to go. So as we get closer to No Child Left Behind, the federal mandates, reaching their ultimate goal of 100% proficiency for all students in core content areas, it becomes more difficult for local communities to understand that an Avondale Academy and other alternative high schools are doing an excellent job at educating students because their progress is significant, but there's a lot of ground to make up, and it's a little bit crazy for all of us to think that we're all going to have 100% proficiency in reading math, science, and social studies at the same time, at the same age for all students.
Mm-hmm. It just allows students, again, that opportunity to be proficient, as you said, in going forward, because a lot of times students continue to get moved forward regardless of knowledge or skills that they may or may not have learned in the classroom.
Right. Well, think of the way we grow as adults. We don't grow all in one straight line.
Mm-hmm.
We grow in fits and starts, and there are moments when we learn a lot, and there are some other moments where we're kind of passive in life, and students are the same way. There's great opportunity for students at the academy to have this burst of learning that they're prepared for and motivated to do, and we want to provide them that opportunity.
And with the smaller classroom sizes, there's a little bit more attention from, teacher
from
to the student.
Yeah.
Maybe they feel a little bit more comfortable asking questions, whereas in a larger setting, it would, they might be embarrassed to raise their hand or
Could be. It's easier to build a relationship in a smaller setting than it is a traditional high school sometimes.
Absolutely. Yeah. So now let's talk to Chuck and our guest today. We have with us Kimberly. She is a current student at the Academy. And we also have Allison, who is a graduate of the Academy. So we're going to talk to them both and talk about their successes. So first, we'll talk to Kimberly. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I'm interested in learning about your experiences at the Academy and why you chose the Academy and how it's helped you.
Well, actually, my dad moved further away, with his work, so I didn't really have a ride to my school. And a friend of my sister's told us about the virtual school, and I love it there. It's a good school.
Now, are you taking any classes that you really like?
Yeah, I'm taking healthy living right now. It's a really fun class. I'm learning a lot with it. And I'm also taking algebra too, advanced algebra.
Okay. And you're in your second year, and will you continue to stay through graduation?
Definitely, yeah.
Great, great. Are there any other experiences you want to share with us What makes it a little different, perhaps from a traditional classroom setting for you?
There's not like the anxiety in the morning to get ready really quick for school. When you're sick, you don't have to push yourself to go, you know, and
Kimberly is on probably from 7:30 in the morning throughout the day till 8-9 o'clock at night, and she's also taking classes at Sherbaker College, which
so
is kind
the
of a
crossover.
Yeah.
The program that you referred to, Chuck. So it gives you an opportunity to work on high school curriculum and also college level courses. That's great, fantastic for you. Good. And Allison, welcome and thank you for being here.
Oh, thank you for having me.
I understand you're a graduate of the Academy and now you're a student at Baker.
Yes.
So why don't you talk about your experiences that you had at the Academy and how that's helped you transition into Baker College?
Well, when I was in the beginning of my junior year, I developed an anxiety disorder and I was attending Eisenhower High School in the Utica School District at the time, and I was having a hard time sitting in class and focusing on everything because I was having anxiety attacks multiple times every single day. So then a friend told me about Avondale Academy and taking my classes online. So then I started taking them in the beginning of my junior year, and then I graduated in June of last year. And I got a scholarship to Baker, so now I'm attending Baker for respiratory care.
So you're really a success story, you know, coming right out of the Academy. And you brought up a really great point. You said you went to Eisenhower. And Chuck, I think something unique about Avondale Academy is that you don't just serve the students that are currently in your school district. It's open. Can you kind of explain that?
Probably 65-70% of our population is from outside of Avondale, and we are open enrollment. Students walk in the door, they come in with a transcript, a birth certificate, and shot records, and go through an interview process. And if the fit's right both ways, they become part of our family.
Megan, I wanted to ask you, as Kimberly's mother, how the access or the opportunity to have her attend the Academy, what kind of impact has that had on her and your family?
Oh, thank you for that question. The Academy has been absolutely wonderful. I love the virtual program. We as a family completely understand the path to the tertiary education. My one daughter's just finished her master's and my other one is at U of M. Kimberly's the baby in the family, so it's easy for us to just center the whole house around her. And in the morning we might walk the dog or something, and she and I have really bonded. We don't have the anxiety problems that, as Allison was saying, that's so prevalent in larger high schools. And she enjoys watching her progress as well, you know, as she's developing, you know, further getting, progressing into the course as well as the grades. And it's absolutely fabulous. I would recommend it to anybody. And the staff at the Academy is just first rate, top rate.
Chuck, how do students and parents learn more about the Academy, and is it still possible for students to enroll for this academic year?
Short answer to the enrollment question is absolutely. Students can call me personally, 248-537-6600, and ask for me, Chuck Granger, or they can ask for Taylor Chapman, and we will explain to them the program. They can visit us on the Avondale website and get information there, or they can simply walk through the front door, and that address is 260 South Squirrel, Auburn Hills, Michigan.
And can, if you're 18 or 19 years old, can you still sign up for the credit recovery program?
If the student is willing to work, their heart's in the right place, we have a program. One of those three programs will work for them.
That's great. Okay, George, back to you. Currently, you're celebrating several renovations to both your academic facilities and also your athletic facilities as a result of a 2010 bond.
Yes.
Could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, we're very pleased to celebrate with the community the upgrades that we've been able to do, particularly in technology and athletics, as you mentioned. We were able to replace student and staff computers across the district and have upgraded technology, wireless networks established in all of our buildings. And the athletic facilities, particularly at Avondale High School, have been completely rebuilt, and we've gone to an artificial turf field for competition and for practice, increased practice space for student athletics, increased community space in the back with the way things were reconfigured. And the highlight for parents might be the fact that we rebuilt the concession stand, and our boosters seem to be very appreciative of that.
That's great. I think that with the upgrades in both the educational facilities with the Wi-Fi and the technology, it just really seems like everything's moving forward and in such a positive direction.
Well, we're on a pretty nice roll right now. Our student achievement has made steady increases over the last 3 or 4 years. Our ACT scores, and where the Avondale High School places now in the top 12% of high schools across the state of Michigan. We were named an AP School of Distinction last year for the number of students we have. You interviewed our National Merit Scholars and those finalists last year. So we want to be a destination school district for families that are moving into the area, and we think we're beginning to create that community for them now.
Yep, and the athletic field is just in time for football season.
It is perfect.
And that's great. Yeah. I want to thank everyone for being here today. It was great talking to you, and it was great to learn more about the Academy and the impact it has on the community and the students. So thank you all very much for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
We'll be back shortly with a segment on some of the great fall events that we have planned at the city, and we'll be joined by Mikey Gorak of our Recreation Department.
Are you aware of a nonprofit organization looking for an opportunity to promote its cause? CMN-TV provides that opportunity. Area nonprofit organizations are encouraged to visit our studio in Troy to take part in Reaching Out, a series that airs on local cable TV in 11 cities in Oakland County. Spread your message, recruit members and volunteers, announce upcoming events. This is an opportunity you just can't ignore. To schedule a taping date, call CMN-TV at 248-589-7778 or visit our website, cmntv.org, for more information.
And welcome back to Inside Auburn Hills. And I'm joined by Mikey from our Recreation Department. And it's funny, on my way here to the studio today, I got stuck behind a truck full of pumpkins. And it just really definitely reminded me that fall is here, and it really prompted me to think about all the really wonderful programs that we have in Auburn Hills. So I wanted to ask you first, thank you first.
Thank you.
For being with us today on the show, and wanted to ask you about Fall Festival in the Woods. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
Great. Well, first off, the Fall Festival in the Woods will take place on Saturday, October 15th. It'll run from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., and that'll take place out at Hawkwoods Nature Center, which is located at 3799 Bald Mountain Road.
And there's some really fun, it's a really great family event. What kind of activities are you going to have?
We have all types of activities planned for the whole family. We're taking the festival this year and bringing the community together to offer a variety of outdoor activities. We're using the elements we're surrounded with to make crafts for the kids using leaves and sticks and twigs that we have out there. So a variety of crafts that will be going on. We'll have hay rides, pumpkin carving. We'll have a local vendor out there selling pumpkins, hay bales, corn stalks. We're offering cider and donuts, homemade chili, along with possibly bringing in an electric car to add to our greener event that we're trying to promote this year at Hawkwoods.
That's great. And for those people who haven't been to Hawkwoods, I mean, the setting is really perfect. There's a big lodge, and we have new cabins. So I think it's really the location that makes for a really great event.
The location is ideal. As you mentioned, it is at Hawkwoods. It's an 80-acre parcel of property that we have with 6 sleeping cabins and the lodge, along with the Nature Center building. And our trail system wraps all throughout the property, along with a nice wetland area that visitors and guests of the Fall Festival will get to view while they're there. And they can do that either walking the trails, or if they'd like to take the hay ride, we ride right down the trails past the wetland area for a nice viewing location.
What a great event. I've been a couple of times myself, and it is absolutely, it is so much fun. The cider and the donuts, I mean, just there's so much to do, and it's great.
Yeah, it's a wonderful event. It's nice to see the community come together, everybody having a good time. A favorite of theirs is listening to the entertainment we've had. We've had the Blue Water Ramblers coming back, and they interact great with the community, along with Petting Farm's a popular activity as well.
That's great. And on the heels of this event, you have another event, the Halloween Trail.
Our Halloween Trail, yes, which is another exciting event. We have close to probably 1,000 people that attend every year. That event will take place on Thursday, October 27th. From 6 p.m. to 7:30, and that takes place right at the Auburn Hills Community Center. The children and families actually trick-or-treat down a spooky trail, not super haunted, scary for the children, just a little spooky, to about 12 different stations that are decorated, and they're able to trick-or-treat and get goodies and candy from the different stations that we have. Once they exit the trail, they actually head into the community center, and we have a magic show that goes on.
Oh, wow.
They have an opportunity to get their picture taken, along with the library comes over and tells some spooky stories for us as well. And we have a new portion to the Halloween Trail this year. We're working to have a little haunted bus that will take place as the children are standing in line waiting to head onto the trail. They'll actually enter the haunted bus first and grab a few goodies and then head on into the trail. So we're excited about that.
It sounds like this event has just grown tremendously over the years. And I hope I can bring my son this year. I think he was a little young last year. Is there an age limit for the trick-or-treaters?
I'm glad you asked that. Yes, 12 and under, and dressed in costume, and it's free for children 12 and under.
That's great. Yeah. And then one of my favorite events that I work with the Recreation Department on is our Downtown Spooktacular. Why don't you talk a little bit about that event?
Yes, that event seems to be growing and growing every year that we run it. That is actually held in downtown Auburn Hills, right on Auburn Road. The local merchants, the businesses in the area, will set up little stations either inside their business or on the sidewalk, and the children will actually trick-or-treat from business to business.
Right in the downtown?
Right in the downtown area.
Right along Auburn Road.
It's great. I think we had about 200 plus last year that were out for that event.
Yep. And we had great weather.
And the weather was great, yes. Because in previous years, you're right, we haven't had such good weather, but last year was phenomenal.
Yep. And that event will be from 12 to 2 p.m.
12 to 2 p.m. Right in the downtown. You just show up and you start walking the streets to the different local businesses that have their activities set up out front of their business.
Yeah, and we encourage our business community to dress up their storefronts and hand out some really cool treats.
Yes, we go around asking the downtown businesses to jump in and participate, and like I mentioned earlier, more and more participation is taking place, and they're doing a fabulous job of decorating the outsides of their stores and making the event a really success for the community in the downtown area.
Not to go into December already, because we're talking about our fall events, but I just wanted to touch briefly on some planning that's happening for our downtown tree lighting ceremony on Friday, December 2nd. So I understand through the grapevine that there's going to be some new and exciting additions to this event. So if you just want to talk a little bit about it, we'll get it on the people's calendar and see what's going to go on.
Absolutely. We are very excited about the tree lighting this year. New highlights that we're going to that are going to take place are we're putting up a big tent, a heated tent that will have some entertainment, arts and crafts, and different things going inside the tent, along with we're going to offer some horse-drawn carriage rides, which is pretty exciting to bring to the downtown area, along with bonfire pits for s'mores. Mm-hmm. So we're looking forward to that.
Yeah, so we'll have everyone join the mayor and Santa as we light up the entire downtown, because when they throw the switch for the Christmas tree, all of the lights come to the downtown. It's beautiful.
Absolutely. It is a beautiful event that's put on, and the mayor does an excellent job of bringing the community up and getting children involved in lighting that tree and watching the whole downtown light up. It's really spectacular.
Well, thank you so much, Mikey, for being here and talking about some of the great events that we do, and we would like to invite the community to come out, you know, visit our events. And if you need more information on the events, where can people find that?
They can call the community center at 248-370-9353, or you can always visit our website at auburnhills.org and click on community events.
Great. Thank you so much, Mikey.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Thank you for watching this edition of Inside Auburn Hills. Until we see you next time.